Our next panel is on the DREAM Act, and we have May Chen, who will be moderating the panel, and then we've got these three terrific speakers, Russell Lum of the Justice and Peace Representative Little Sisters of the Assumption, Emily Park, Dare to Dream campaign coordinator of the Min Kwan Center for Community Action, and then we have Jimmy Yan, the general counsel from the office of the borough president of New York, rather of Manhattan, Scott Stringer's office. So I'm going to turn the mic over to May and have her get started. Oh, before we get started, we have a very special guest in the house. We have Congresswoman Macy Hirono from Hawaii. And I am going to quote, Suki, because otherwise I don't think I can say this. It's our understanding that she will become the first Asian American senator. That's Suki's prediction. So welcome, Congresswoman.
Yay. Okay, good afternoon, everyone. I'm really, really excited and delighted to be here for a number of reasons, because as Asian Pacific Americans, whether we're immigrants, American-born citizens, documented, undocumented, education has been beat into us as one of the most important values of our communities and families, right? Now, we're here to talk about the DREAM Act, which impacts students, and so it's very, very key and relevant to the issue of education. And I found some data to just put out there as a context. People estimate that 12.3% of DREAM-eligible students all across America are Asian American and Pacific Islanders from the various countries of Asia. But what's even more astonishing than 12.3% is that if you are from California and you are a student at the University of California, where the majority are Asian Americans, 40% of the undocumented students in the UC system are Asian American. And so it's not a surprise that a lot of the activists in our community, the Asian American community, in the DREAM movement are from California. Now, you have to put the DREAM Act and the DREAM movement in the context of our immigration system, which is quite broken. And overall, there are many changes that are needed in immigration policy and immigration system in the United States. But we're living in a really unbelievably negative climate for all immigrants, whether they're documented or undocumented. It's like we're being kicked around like a political football. And you may have followed the news this week of the Supreme Court hearings on the Arizona law, SB 1070, and it's overall very, very negative towards immigrants. So I just want to give a plea, because I've been involved in the immigrant rights movement since the 1980s, that Asian Americans need to be engaged in the immigration debate, because this very much shapes our destiny now and in the future. And our own immigration story, if you study Asian American history of exclusion, of paper sons, of struggling for our rights, and fighting for things like bilingual education and so on, the Asian Americans played a very important role in immigration and immigrant-related issues. So we need to support the DREAM Act for our kids, because this is about our future. So my personal involvement in the DREAM Act actually goes back 10 years ago to 2001, which is when the DREAM legislation was first introduced into Congress. And I remember at that time working for the Garment Workers Union and bringing a bunch of the kids of our members who were DREAM eligible down to Washington to lobby, you know, in Washington, D.C. And this was under the Bush administration. So this legislation has a long history and had different iterations of bipartisan support, but we're faced with the environment today and still struggling. So we have a really great panel, including a dream student and two very active and longstanding advocates for this. And so I want to first introduce Emily Park, who will give you an overview through a PowerPoint presentation and her own story as a dreamer. So, Emily.
Hi, everybody. Thank you for having me here. It's really glad to see everyone here. Wow. So I used to have a freshman orientation and seminars once a month here for the last 4 years in undergrad. So it's kind of funny that I'm here giving a presentation today. Okay, so here we go. So as we all know, there are 11 million undocumented immigrants in the United States. But when we say that, we are talking about children, you know, that because there are 2 million of them are students. Many of these students are brought here at a young age by their parents, and many times we really don't think about that. And it makes one wonder, how did this happen? So can this happen in 1 year, 5, 10? I mean, this country is founded by, you know, this country is the country of immigrants. And when was the last time this, you know, our government has passed any, like, real, you know, comprehensive immigration reform? Can somebody tell me when was the last time? Yes, the Immigration Reform and Control Act of 1986. So, take a look at this. When we say that there are a lot of undocumented immigrants, a lot of people think that that's a Latino issue. Not, you know, us, the model immigrants, the Asians, don't do things like illegal migration or, you know, staying in the U.S. illegally. But, you know, as this chart shows, there are a lot of us. And we, you know, it makes us think, why do people come here, you know, take the risk of being deported, risking everything that they have? And as we all know, you know, people come for many different reasons, but the most prominent reason is to give a better chance, not for themselves, but for their children, right? But growing up as undocumented is really hard. So let's talk about the barriers undocumented students face. The financial aid, most of all, IDs, driver's license, no job, even after getting a college degree, and of course, no legalization. So bam, to break this barriers, the Dream Act happened. Sorry, I was supposed to have a sound effect. So, we all know who this is, right? Senator Dick Durbin. So the Dream Act was introduced in 2001. It has been over 11 years, and it was reintroduced many times ever since. But what happened in 2010? Something very important personally, and I believe as well as historically, happened in 2010. The Federal Dream Act, for the very first time, passed in the House of Representatives. But soon after, it failed in the Senate. But, you know, it was the very first time we actually saw that this was really going to happen, that, you know, we actually saw the hope that, you know, this could really happen if we work hard, if we work harder. All these dream activists, you know, they're all students and, you know, a lot of allies. And we've done numerous petitions, hunger strikes, civil disobedience, walk across America. There's really nothing these students hadn't done. Yeah, but the Dream Act failed. So ever since the failure of the Federal Dream Act, a lot of states have been working very hard in passing their own state version of the Dream Act. And from my point of view, this is really important because this, you know, passing the state Dream Act not only would help, you know, students in each state get better access to higher education, but I'm hoping that this should be a stepping stone for the Federal Dream Act to happen again. So California, as an example, California is the state that passed their own state version of the Dream Act last year. They fought really hard for the last, you know, 7-8 years. They did numerous rallies, petition drives, hunger strikes, education sessions, workshops, civil disobedience. Yep. And this is one of the campaigns that they led. It's called The Glasses Is Still Half Empty. So what happened in California was that they ended up splitting the bills into two. So one was called AB 130, another one was called AB 131. AB 130 was for private scholarships, and AB 131 was for public tuition aid. And they were able to pass the easier version of the Dream Act, right, the AB 131 first, because it was funded by private donors. But I think the government was reluctant to pass the AB 131, which was the real deal, the state-funded tuition aid program. So, and they were able to pass the both version of the Dream Act, but the governor was still very reluctant to sign it. I mean, Governor Jerry already stated that during his election campaign, he explicitly said that he was going to sign the petition, he was going to sign the Dream Act, but it took a long time for him to actually sign it. So Nancy Meza, she was a UCLA student, did a campaign called the Sign It, Jerry, and Jerry signed. Okay. So let's talk about the New York. It makes me wonder how come states like California, Connecticut, and New Mexico, and Texas have passed their own version of the Dream Act, but how come New York is so far behind? So let's go over the eligibility criteria for the New York State Dream Act to see, you know, who'd be actually eligible for this Dream Act. It's pretty narrow, that because the eligibility criteria is very strict. You have to have graduated from high school or get a GED, have entered the United States before the age of 18, you know, be under the age of 35, and not have been convicted in this state or any other state or territory of the this country for violent felony. And here is a very dense comparison of the New York State Dream legislation. So this is summary of the New York State Dream legislation. I say Dream legislation instead of the Dream Act because there are more than one bill. The first one is called the Dream Fund. It's sponsored by Assemblyman Moyes and Senator Espelet, and this is modeled after Illinois' Dream Act. And this would offer private fund. So this would be like similar to AB 130 that California had. And another one is called the New York State Dream Act. This is the actual Dream Act that I want to emphasize because this is equivalent to AB 131 of California's bill. And this would offer tuition aid program, which is a state-funded public tuition aid. And also open up the SUNY, CUNY scholarships and other types of state-aided tuition aids or scholarships. And the third one is called the Regions Bill. It's right now it's you know, being sponsored by Assemblywoman Deborah Glick. And this is very similar to the New York State Dream Act. And from what I know, they're trying to merge these two bills into one. And 529 savings account, this is just a small thing that's tagged along. So we are trying to change the eligibility criteria for 529 savings account. is that it used to be that you have to have a social security number to open up this account, but now we are changing into trying to change it into like 18, like individual tax identification number. So, so the state of the New York State Dream legislation, the New York State Dream Act and the Dream Fund had a hearing last year, December 9th, in front of the City Hall. And ever since, we've been fighting very hard to get those passed. So it didn't get into the governor's budget, but that means, you know, we have to fight harder to get the actual bill passed first. So how many students and how many money are we talking about? This is really important, right? Because if it were something that would drain our economy even more, then maybe we should think about it again. But as you could see, it's $17 million of the entire education budget. It sounds a lot, right? But what it actually means is that this would add about 3.44 cents if you're earning $100,000 to $200,000 a year, which is the cost of a pizza and Diet Coke, and $1.34 if you make $60,000 to $75,000. You could buy maybe a slice of pizza at Two Bros in Manhattan, and it'll add about 8 cents to your annual tax if you are making around 20,000 or less. So we are basically, you know, saying that, hey, if you could maybe not have a slice of pizza a year, you could help, you know, these many students. And these students, because not all undocumented students are actually DREAM eligible, you know, youth, because of our strict criteria, it actually comes down to just 2% of the entire high school graduates every year. So the economic benefits the DREAM Act will bring, this is based on the Federal DREAM Act. So this will cut the deficit by $1.4 billion and increase government revenues by $2.3 billion over the next 10 years. And the DREAM Act will also add between $1.4 to $3.6 trillion in taxable income to our economy. I mean, this is common sense, right? The higher degree you have, the better job you get. And, you know, if you make more money, you'll probably have to pay more taxes. So these DREAM eligible students will eventually contribute back to the society. So this is the most important part of my presentation. So how do you get involved? You could call this number, 518-474-8390, and say, hey, Governor Cuomo, pass the DREAM Act this year. And you could do as little as signing a petition, which I brought right here. I'm going to distribute this and collect this at the end of the session. And you could also visit your local elected officials. So Minkwon Center is part of the New York State Dream Coalition. And what we do at the New York State Dream Coalition is that we, one of the many things that we focus on is, you know, the advocacy works. And we have a list of elected officials that we need to make visits. So if you want to make a legislative visit, please let us know. Okay. Yeah, for more information, contact Minkwon Center. Thank you.
Thanks, Emily. That was really thorough information, and I get to build on it in a couple of ways and make it a little more specific. So again, my name's Russell. I work for the Little Sisters of the Assumption, and one of the things I'm going to do in my remarks is tell you like what that means and how I ended up being a DREAM Act advocate. But I'm also going to, I'm also in the New York State DREAM Coalition and can tell this group where we are in the campaign and just how likely it is that the DREAM Act will pass. And the take-home point will be that, yes, we need you and you must get involved because this is a push and that this matters. And I hope also to to bring us around to maybe some of the faith and moral reasons and rights reasons why the DREAM Act makes so much sense and is the least that we can ask for, and really is the least that we deserve in our communities and as people. So I am on a full-time volunteer basis an activist with an order of Catholic sisters. They have a volunteering program, and a year ago when I was a student in Los Angeles, I agreed to be their justice and peace representative. So I work for an order of Catholic sisters, and I live with them, and this order deals with an immigrant population up in East Harlem. So I fight on immigration issues, and that puts me in the room at the New York State Dream Coalition, and that's sort of my in. And I come from a kind of from an educational background that makes our politicization and our conscientization, as it is called, important. So I was Catholicly educated and Jesuit educated, and for me that meant like an education for solidarity, an education for politics. And I think that some of the things that get asked today, excitingly, are like, how do we get politicized, or how do we get conscientized, or how do we get our communities to politicize, or how do we get our communities to conscientize? And I think that it's interesting from my perspective that as a person of color and as an Asian, I'm half Chinese, it wasn't because I come from an immigrant community or from a Chinese-American community that I was conscientized. It was because I was educated in a particular way and basically by Jesuits. So I think that has implication for what we need to be doing better as Asian communities and how we can rally around issues when we see them better. So the DREAM Act it was supposed to be automatic. The only reason, and I think it's been said already, but the only reason we fight for a state DREAM Act is because the federal DREAM Act passed, and the only reason that we fight for the federal DREAM Act is because there isn't an amnesty bill, basically. It's because there isn't a comprehensive immigration reform. And so it's all supposed to be low-hanging fruit, and it's all the bare minimum on our rights as people who are promised an education. The New York public education system wants to put you through places like CUNY, but seems not to want to put undocumented students through places like CUNY, which is their right. And that's sort of what puts us here, and what puts us really, I would say, radical and militant about the DREAM Act, because it's time. So next week, one of the bills that Emily showed us was the Dream Fund. Next week, the Dream Fund comes to a vote in the New York State Assembly. And so that would be the equivalent of California's AB 130 comes to a vote here in New York State next week. And it very likely will pass, at which point, like in California, we will say, thanks, but finish the job. Or in California, they said, fill it up. And we are about to be at that stage of our campaign for the New York State DREAM Act. We are about to say, thank you for establishing a fund that private entities and businesses fill up for students to be able to go to college, but now allocate public funds to it. And that happens through the New York State DREAM Act, this one bill. The legislative season is like nearly 5 weeks or 4 weeks till it's over. So we have like 4 or 5 weeks. We need sort of all hands on deck. The New York State DREAM Act lacks about 7 or 8 votes in the Senate, and it lacks about 15 votes in the Assembly. I mean, I'm not one of the person who makes the calls to the legislators, so I'm not utterly sure. But that's what we're facing, and that's what you can get involved in. And I can just say just a little bit more about what the New York State Dream Coalition did just this last Monday, when we realized that our strength as a coalition is not the technical budgetary arguments for this bill. Our strength as a coalition is the rights-based arguments for this bill. And so on that recognition, and because our coalition has a faith group, like basically a subcommittee, we said, let's be good at what we're good at, which is making this a moral claim and using our faith organizations and our faith organizing and using our moral and rights-based claims to be loud about the DREAM Act, because like I say, we have some 4 or 5 weeks. So we did that on Monday. We had a press conference in the Lower East Side at St. Teresa's Church as a way to say, this is our call as a state to really live out what it is that we purport to care about for people graduating from New York State high schools. We purport to care about their higher education. Live it and bear the cost of that. And as was really well explained, the cost of that is pretty minimal. If the New York State DREAM Act were to pass, the portion of the TAP budget that would go to DREAMers would be 1% of the larger TAP budget. And so the more conservative members in our legislature and Governor Cuomo, since he is not behind this legislation, would basically say, well, we have to look at the financial reasons. The budgetary technical reasons are going to be their arguments. And our arguments are going to be give what we deserve and what you've promised. Not to mention that argument stinks. 1% of the larger TAP budget is nothing. And I think that I think that the way to involve us at this point is to sort of target people in the state legislature who are not on board, and to continue to be about petitions and to be about politics, because that's a challenge for us. And I love that this conference is about that. How can we be about politics, or to what extent are we already political? What are the ways we need to be political now? And I think here's one.
Okay, and our final speaker is Jimmy Yan, and I hope there'll be a little time maybe for a couple questions. Jimmy?
Hey, thanks. My name is Jimmy Yan. I'm the general counsel of the Manhattan Borough President's Office. Borough President of Manhattan is Scott Stringer. And so I'm here to mostly present the voice and role of government in the DREAM movement. Ming-Kwan, Emily, and community grassroots activism. Russell is also with community activism, but bringing in the institutions of faith. Government is also a part of this coalition, whether formally or informally. I also personally come from a background of work in immigrant rights policy. I used to work in the mayor's office of immigrant affairs under Bloomberg for a few years, and prior to that was a public interest attorney for several years, focusing a lot on immigrant rights. So I'll bring a little bit of that perspective. But I just want to share with you a few instances of when government plays a really important role as an ally in this coalition in the DREAM movement. Borough President Stringer, of course, has been a really strong proponent of DREAM legislation. And I want to give you a few examples of how government can help through some of our work. Currently, something that we're doing is trying to get all the Manhattan community boards to support the DREAM legislation by going out and getting them to vote in support of it and educating them on what this means. Community boards are these volunteer public, there are city agencies. There are 12 community boards in Manhattan, about, I don't remember, 59 or so throughout the whole city. Each of them has 50 appointed volunteer members. They're all appointed by the borough president. And there's a body called the Manhattan Borough Board that comes together every month that consists of all the council members and community boards of that borough. So the borough president introduced a resolution to have everyone on the borough board come out in support of DREAM legislation. I would say this would be more valuable if it came from, to be honest, if it came from someplace, some other place in New York or there might be more folks on the fence, but it's still been a very valuable process and extremely valuable to have more vast formal support from the whole borough of Manhattan in support of this. And we're looking forward to announcing that when it's ready. Advocates have been going to the community boards to actually educate the community and board people about the DREAM legislation. Even though you have a lot of liberal folks in Manhattan, a lot of them don't know what the DREAM legislation is all about or aren't tapped into the immigrant rights movement. So I think that whole engagement process with the community boards that our office has initiated is a valuable thing, and we hope that gets wrapped up very, very quickly. Also, another way that government can help is looking for ways to provide resources to immigrant students and undocumented immigrant students to support them through school. Back in 2007, 2008, Borough President Stringer started, one of his first initiatives was creating a program called Civic Leaders of Tomorrow, which is a fellowship program that was designed to give a modest stipend, $1,000 for one semester for a handful of students to help them with their educate, to help support them through their school, their higher education, and also give them a little bit of money to help them intern someplace at an organization focused on immigrant rights, because we know in this competitive society, it can be hard to get good work experience, to get internships, and I feel like the world is a lot more capitalist than when I was a kid, and there's less support for advocacy and not-for-profit work. So we want to make sure that there's more opportunity for students to get experience in social change. So the underlying inspiration for this was the DREAM Act, and putting out more money for kids to be able to go to school. As government, because of the ways it's set up, we couldn't check people for their status, their immigration status, but we targeted broadly, sectors, fields that, where we felt that we could reach undocumented students, and we know that we were able to touch at least a few over the years. I'm very happy to say that, and we have one of our first civic leaders of tomorrow in the auditorium, Jin Liu, who I believe was in our first class, who's one of the most it's great to see him here, and he really stood out to me when we interviewed him and throughout. So we've gotten a tremendous group of students who have had never had a single internship in their lives before they did civic leaders, and just ended up being, so this, it was really, I think, critical program for a lot of folks. And, I'll just throw in two other examples. Our office was very involved in fighting back Secure Communities, the program that would have enlisted law enforcement into checking immigration databases for anyone that was arrested. Borough President Stringer and our office, we organized sign-on letters with a lot of legislators from throughout the city to oppose that, which fortunately Cuomo then agreed to oppose, but now we face a different situation, as you know, with a different interpretation. Conflict with the federal government. We're also recently able to help a young man, Muhammad Azam, avoid deportation. Again, that was a situation where NYU Law School Immigrant Rights Clinic and a lot of advocates were helping this young man who was pretty much a dreamer before. Now he's graduated and was facing deportation for very unfair reasons, and it was a situation where having an elected official get involved to get this story into the New York Times was seen to make the difference in getting the Department of Homeland Security to actually change their mind and decide not to prosecute him anymore. So those are just some examples I want to lay out as strategies and ways that government and elected officials are, as you, a lot of you probably know already, can be valuable in really furthering the movement that advocates are starting and sustaining. So I encourage you to. I'd like to know who the standout elected officials are and whether any of them are in New York City on this legislation. But that's so that's the message I wanted to give you. Thanks.
Thanks, Jimmy. I think we have time for a couple of questions, and I'll just comment on some of the legislative targets that I'm aware of. I'm speaking today on behalf of the New York State Immigrant Action Fund, and I left some flyers about our website and just general information out there. But I was trying to help set up an appointment with Senator Marty Golden in Brooklyn. And the Senate side is a major target because the Senate in New York State is Republican controlled, and it's very hard to get some kind of a majority vote from that group. So, but Golden apparently is refusing to meet any advocates on the DREAM Act. So I would suggest anyone who lives in Bay Ridge, this is Brooklyn, write letters or make phone calls or do what you can to just put some pressure onto his office. And then the other major targets are in Long Island. So, you know, if you look at the census data, more and more Asians and Latinos are living in Long Island now. And a lot of the Senate side committee chairmen, like education and so on, higher ed, they're in Long Island. So if any of you is either from Long Island, or I know that OCA Long Island is here, you know, we should talk about how to, and we are setting up legislative visits with some of the representatives there. That's just a little piece of what I know. I don't know if Emily or Russell, you have anything else on that. But the petitions are with Emily and or any of us. You can sign as an individual or as, even better, as an organization. And are there any questions or comments from the audience? Okay, yeah, May.
Oh, I think just in terms of legislative targets, the Speaker of the House, I mean, to the Assembly side, I mean, is, you know, representative of the lower Manhattan. And even though Manhattan is a very liberal place, as you say, you know, he holds a lot of power in the Assembly and has power to move a lot of things. So, I don't think he's against any of this stuff, but I think it's always helpful for Manhattan residents or lower Manhattan residents, you know, who care to at least speak with him about, or, you know, to call him and meet with him, speak with him about what he's saying.
Yeah, I mean, definitely in New York State, the so-called proverbial three men in a room, Governor Cuomo, Assembly Speaker Silver, and Senate Skelos, yeah, are definitely targets. Other questions? Somebody else had their hand up? Okay, well, thank you very much.
Thank you to May and the panelists for your perspectives. It's really very important to hear from the constituents who are particularly impacted by this and to hear from those that support them and can also inform us about the various perspectives. Thank you.